The question is, if I approach the rental housing tribunal for assistance and they decide a particular matter in my favor, i.e. granting me some form of relief, what can I do if my tenant or landlord fails to abide by the tribunal's ruling? What action can I take in that case? Selma?
Yes, so the rental housing tribunal, I must say, I very often refer clients for rental collections or deposit refund issues, those kind of problems. I refer clients to the tribunal because the amount we're talking about, your legal costs, if you go to an attorney, is very often far more than what your actual claim amount is. And because you can go to the tribunal for free, I do recommend that in a case like reclaiming your deposit or a smaller arrear rental claim, something like that. And the reason for that is the order that you get from the rental housing tribunal carries the exact same weight as an order from a magistrate's court. So what you do, if they don't perform, say for instance, the tribunal ordered that the tenant has to pay the arrear rental or the landlord has to refund the deposit, there's a monetary element to that. What you do is you get the judgment from the tribunal, you go to the magistrate's court in that area, and we call it a CCJ, a certified copy of the judgment, and they issue a warrant of execution then in the magistrate's court. So it's exactly the same. You act on it as you would in the case of a judgment in the magistrate's court. You take your warrant of execution to the sheriff of the court, and the sheriff will then attend to the execution of the judgment, meaning will go to the person's property, see what they can attach in lieu of satisfaction of the judgment, and then everybody is happy. Very often, by the time you get to the sheriff, it's going to cost more than the potential benefits. So even in that case, just weigh up your cost to benefit and be careful of matters of principle. Principle matters has put many attorneys' kids through varsity, and I know Bruno neither are those guys, but I have seen clients come to us and they say this is a matter of principle, and the first thing I would do is it's my ethical obligation to talk you out of your matter of principle, because your matter of principle is only going to end up in my bank account, and that's not really going to help anybody. Yeah. But sometimes it is actually worth it, and you might want to pursue that.
Yeah, it's so true. And principle only lasts for so long. So you think that principle is something that it just endures throughout. But I can promise you, like 3 to 6 months, principle's out the window. But now you've actually forked out money. So yeah, I totally agree with you, Selna. So I don't necessarily... So I'll refer people to the Rental Housing Tribunal for rental collections under certain circumstances, especially if they want to go the whole nine yards. And the quantum isn't very high and they've got time on their hands. So there, I totally agree. So the only thing with the magistrate's courts that I do like is sometimes I tell clients, listen, if you don't think that you're going to go the full extent, maybe you'll issue one warrant and that's it. At least you can get the a default listing, which sits against the tenant. And then at least like in a year's time, when they go apply for finance, they find this against their name and they have to come running back to you to try to settle the debt in order to get a rescission of judgment. But that's the one benefit of magistrate's court that I do like. If the landlord wants, because obviously there's a cost associated to that. So the landlord needs to be willing to say, great, I'll put this cost in the hope that, this guy actually comes round in a year or two and the debt gets settled. But short of that, to Silna's point, the reality is that an award from the tribunal can be executed the same way that an order from the magistrate's court can. So if you're going to go the whole nine yards, you're going to trace this guy, try to get your money back, and you've got time on your hands, go for it. It's not a bad process. And sometimes if they actually manage to bring the tenants to the table, some of the guys there that mediate initially, do push their point across. So I've seen a decent amount of settlements coming out of it if you can get the tenant to the table.
Exactly. And I want to add to that. I think that's one of the big reasons, exactly what you said about the default listing against the person's name. That's one of the main reasons I love TPN's way of data collection, the tenant payment profile data. So you can select on TPN's system a tenant did not pay or paid late, and you don't need a judgment for that. You don't need to even do a letter of demand. You just record the tenant sure. did not pay if he didn't pay. And that data is unaffected by credit amnesties. So yeah. I think in any event, I wish all landlords would, agents, just put in the effort, log into TPN, update the tenant payment profile data, because that sure. data will sit there forever and ever.
Absolutely, yeah.
But yeah. yeah, I agree with you. Sometimes a judgment could be a handy thing.